The worlds of television are oftentimes some of the most enticing and fantastic any of us could ever hope to imagine. Serial storytelling combined with strong characters and world-building can make even some of the lowest-budget television work resonate strongly with an audience simply because of the advantages its format levies over many others. Where films may fail to pick up the slack when it comes to motivations, character progressions, and so on, television can deliver in many ways simply by virtue of having more wiggle room to work with. That is, of course, unless you're Mirai Nikki. Mirai Nikki, or Future Diary in English, is a Japanese animated television series produced by Studio Azreed and based on a manga of the same title by author and artist Sakai Esuno. It was directed by Naoto Hosoda and began airing on October 10th, 2011, with the final episode airing on April 16th, 2012, and an epilogue OVA episode releasing on June 19th of the following year. The series, as well as its OVA, have been licensed for North American distribution both on digital and home video by Funimation Entertainment. The musical score was composed by Tatsuya Kato, and the series originally aired on both Chiba TV and TV Saitama in Japan. The story follows the events of the Diary Game, which is a battle to the death between 12 people who are given future diaries, special cell phone diaries that can predict the future by the god of time and space known as Deus Ex Machina. Deus has given the 12 users the chance to participate in the game so that the winner may succeed him in godhood and rule the world in his stead. The story's premise, while dark, does offer somewhat of an enticing setup with an interesting idea to rope us in. So first, I suppose it's prudent we talk a little bit about the genre that kicked this whole morbid fascination off in the first place. Part 1. The Battle Royale genre. While the concept of a battle royale has been a staple of large combative events since around the 18th century, the term found itself being forever redefined in the 21st century, with the release of a 2000 Japanese film entitled Battle Royale, which itself was based on a 1999 novel of the same name. In Battle Royale, the novel by Japanese author Koshin Takami, a group of junior high school students are drugged while being apparently taken on a field trip and forced to fight each other to the death over on a secluded island that they can't escape from by an authoritarian Japanese government. The film adaptation, while highly successful, was also quite controversial, earning it condemnation by Japan's National Diet upon release. Despite its graphic content and horrifying premise, it's rather easy to see why such a story resonated with the people who picked it up at the time. It focuses on what, at the time, felt like the vague notion of a possible future, ruled by a fascist government that quells rebellion with military force, that controls everything and decides what is immoral and illegal based on what benefits them personally. They bend the whims of the populace to their will, and although to some of us, living in such a world can be seen as somewhat hyperbolic, there's an underlying truth to the horror of a scenario like that. And although there has, to my knowledge, never been a government who forcibly dropped a group of high schoolers into a remote setting and made them kill each other to aid with government and military research and instill terror and distrust into its nation's citizens to curb rebellion efforts, the root of this kind of terror rests inside the crevice of a real, tangible, systemic critique, and a warning flag for how things could go if let loose in an authoritarian direction. Not only that, it speaks to the innate fear of a sort of primal or natural sense of human savagery, the capacity for others to betray or lie to you to get the chance to hurt you. It's a genre trenched both in the potential for political and human fear, which is what makes it such a popular recent format, cribbed by so many stories alike. From The Hunger Games, to The Purge, to Danganronpa, to things as simple and silly as Fortnite, the battle royale genre is entrenched in modern pop culture, and that's what gives Mirai Nikki a leg up on premise, by already having a strong backbone to work with. Unfortunately, it loses a lot of that backbone over time, but let's not get ahead of ourselves. First, let's talk about somebody who really has no spine at all. Yukiteru Amano is the main character of Mirai Nikki, and incidentally, probably my second least favorite character in the entire series. He just barely loses out to one other character in particular, but don't worry. We'll get to her. Yuki is a bit of a blank slate everyman in terms of actual personality traits, which is to say he doesn't actively seem to have many. All he does all day long, for the most part, is keep to himself, talk to no one, and jot down a diary of all his peripheral surroundings in his cell phone. Nobody tell him that typing a detailed journal on a flip phone keypad would absolutely suck. If he's not bumming around looking at his phone, though, he's huddling up underneath a blanket in his room to talk to what he thinks is an imaginary friend, the god of the universe named Deus Ex Machina, Of course, Deus is not an imaginary friend and is the real god, but frankly, it's sad enough that Yuki thought he was fake and spent his only free time away from his cell phone talking to the big weird skeleton godman he thought was a figment of his imagination. From Deus, Yuki receives a future diary on his phone, which starts to predict things he experiences in the future, which is when the whole survival game aspect is thrown into the mix and introduced to us. Each diary user also has a diary on their phone, which acts as both a lifeline that can kill them when destroyed, and as a viewport into the future in some specific way that reflects the user's personality. Yuki has no personality at all, so his diary really only predicts future events he experiences directly. But there are varied other types, like Uryu Minane's escape diary, which gives her the perfect escape route to take, or Yuno's Yukiteru diary, which literally just tells her everything Yuki's going to be doing in the future. The dichotomy of diary users' greatest personal advantage also tangibly acting as their greatest weakness is an interesting idea, but unfortunately it isn't really played to great effect, and especially not with Yuki, who spends so much of his screen time never dedicating to a game plan that you wonder why he even bothers carrying the thing around if he's just going to cry and do nothing anyway. There's an interesting deduction angle when it comes to discerning each player's identity as well, but again, this rarely comes into play, and when it does, it's very clunky at best, which is a word I'd also use to describe Yuki's first victory at the end of episode 1, which feels very not earned, since even though he throws the dart, Yuno kind of did all the planning for him. Oh, by the way, this is Yuno. We'll be getting to know her in more detail later, but what you need to know for now is that she's a stalker, who's obsessively in love with main character Kun for very contrived reasons, and is exceptionally violent, incredibly possessive, and just generally awful in every way. Okay, that's out of the way. Let's keep talking about Yuki. The main problem that arises from the beginning of the series and rides out to the very end with Yukiteru is extremely simple. He is a coward. And no, I'm not talking Shinji cowardice, where you can kind of understand where the poor kid's coming from, but some of the things Yuki falls back on are things you really think a guy should come to terms with within 26 episodes of television, but he never does. He consistently falls back on even some of the most basic autonomy in situations, satisfied with only taking the kill shot if he tends to do anything in particular, and even then it will take him a long time of whining to get there. He's content to just use Yuno by rationalizing it as utilization, but in reality he really is just hanging back and allowing her to fight all of his battles for him because he's too afraid to take charge of any given situation, which isn't exactly what inspires confidence in your supposedly relatable everyman protagonist. He's a main character that, for lack of a better term, is barely even active in what's considered to be his own story, and it creates a huge disconnect between us as viewers and Yuki's struggles because, well, it really is hard to sympathize with someone who just isn't trying. Not only that, his personality isn't exactly prize-winning either when he has any of it to spare, beyond just being a cardboard cutout with no opinion of his own. He openly shows a rather juvenile distaste for others, up to ruminating wistfully on the idea of people at a theme park horribly dying in a tragic accident, for the fake, deep, nihilistic lulls, I guess. And for a guy who so consistently seems to revel in self-pity and the worst outcome projections, he also seems extremely naive? He reaches out for alliances between diary users that any sane person could see as a double cross coming a mile away. He consistently keeps giving Yuno a second chance, although to be fair, that's less to do with not realizing she sucks and more because he's too scared to fight his own fights. And he barely even takes charge in social situations where there's something that needs to be said or done. Oh, Yuno, you're hiding something from me. Yep, I am. And then he just doesn't follow up. He doesn't follow up at all. Why would you not prod any further at that subject? In fact, some of his worst failings are just to do with Yuno in general, when he's not content to let her nearly get herself killed every other episode because he won't step in to do anything, he's never stopping her or barely trying to stop her when she inevitably does something awful, which is a lot, by the way. On top of that, he's just fairly incompetent. He can't boil water. He cries as Yuno and his mom discover his porn collection. He's so insecure that he sounds like he wants to die when his mom is doing something as simple as showing someone his baby pictures. He flip-flops between knowing Yuno is a bad person, 100% for sure, and then trying to rationalize her behavior to himself because he thinks she's hot. And yet somehow God of the Universe over here is like, I selected based on uniqueness of character. Hey God, maybe this is a bad time? I know you got this whole tournament thing to run, but Yukiteru Amino has no discernible personality. In fact, that's another thing I find really weird about Yuki's lack of personality is how much so many people in the show really like him. Yuno, of course, is blisteringly in love with him beyond all rational thought, but then you have Tsubaki hitting on him, Akise hitting on him, all these friends who would gladly risk their lives for him, Minane admitting to have a begrudging affection for him, Deus thinking he's unique, other players conceding that they think he's gonna win the game. It's like everything in the universe bows to the mighty will of the destiny of Yuki, like he's the most important jigsaw piece in the world puzzle. But he sucks, and even then, as much of a kicked puppy Yuki is, the holder of the leash is even worse than he is. You know Gasai is the secondary protagonist of the story, a girl who is 150% romantically obsessed with Yuki, and also just a bit off-kilter in the most ludicrously extreme way. There's a reason that when you search the term yandere, pictures of Yuno will almost inevitably surface, because her penchant for possessiveness, stalkery, obsessive and manipulative behavior is one of, if not the most defining aspects of her personality, and it is not utilized flatteringly in the slightest. She comes across fairly weirdly right off the bat in her introduction in episode 1, where she hyper-competently leads a confused Yuki through the process of escaping a serial killer who is also a diary user, and randomly kisses him. Not only is her affection so wildly out of left field, but it doesn't really get much less confusing with time. Even when they approach the apparent reason of why Yuno is so attached to him, it comes across as really contrived and shallow, which, incidentally, is how a lot of her characterization comes across in general. Yuno is the worst of the tragic crazy girl archetypes rolled into one, which makes a lot of the worst tropes present in her all the more apparent and insufferable as a result. For one, she's incredibly single-minded on having her way with Yuki, often to the outright dismissal of his feelings on the subject. She comes onto him strong and hard from the very start despite not knowing him very well at all, but also allows herself to be used by him with full knowledge of that because of her level of dedication. She puts people in harm's way that are otherwise innocent or completely non-threatening for the sake of protecting Yuki specifically, and this often results in her doing things he begs her repeatedly not to. In a situation in episode 2, for example, the entire school Yuki attends is held hostage by a notorious terrorist. She's also a diary user, and is asking the kids to hand Yuki Teru over if they want to live. While it's a tough call, the kids decide to sell him out, and Minane instructs everyone that once he's been handed off, the motion sensors are littered around the school and they've been reactivated now. So that will result in everyone blowing sky high if they were to move. Yuno, however, is so angry at a couple of students for individually deciding to wrestle Yuki and hand him over at the behest of saving collectively everyone's lives, that she gets up and makes a beeline through the hallway, allowing multiple people, most of whom are completely blameless in the situation, to die horribly because of a perceived slight on her boyfriend of 5 minutes. In addition to acting with reckless abandon, she often acts possessively or with actively cruel intent. Her concept of love is extremely juvenile, often to the point of seeming compulsive. She forbids Yuki from doing things like she has any right to deny him his own autonomy. She's willing to kill anyone who gets close to Yuki or whom she perceives to get in the way of their relationship, up to and including his own mom, who she doesn't actually attempt to kill, but was planning to if she didn't approve of her. That's sick. You know what else is sick? How violence is basically her only answer to every situation? She's not very pressed against the idea of killing a literal toddler under the same roof as Yuki's mom simply because he happens to be a diary user, which, even if he is, doesn't really inspire confidence in a plan if you're going to do it in front of a regular-ass person. She can't rein herself in, and a lot of times it's left on Yuki's shoulders, as if tacitly implying it should be his obligation to stabilize her. But that should not be his job, especially when it comes to someone so hell-bent on denying him basic human courtesy. Need I remind you that when Yuki first made any friends at all, her first instinct was to kill them, and the second they got into trouble, she attempted to leave them to die. She simply cannot stand the idea of someone else being in his life, and this would maybe make for an interesting character conflict if she was actually billed as a villain for this. But she's not, and she's actively romanticized extremely often in the narrative. She admits up front that she doesn't care about ethics at all, and her backstory is pretty awful, but we'll get back to that later. Yuno is often treated like a victim of her circumstances, and to a degree, she is, but it's the utter lack of self-awareness, the pure unmitigated bitterness she always carries, and the sense of disregard for the pain of anyone who gets in her way that inspires not sympathy but loathing from me. Not only that, her subservience to Yuki is often treated in a very weirdly sexual way. And number one, that's creepy, they're both 14. And number two, it often begins to feel like this 14-year-old girl who is kinda crazy but also completely loyal, who is extremely smart and tactical but sometimes can dramatically become way dumber when it seems like the scene requires her to be more susceptible to the wiles of Yuki's manly savior arms, comes across less as a strong individual character and more like the fantasy girl of a gross writer, not to mention the nearly comical insistence to imparting her with extremely stereotypical mentally ill tropes in combination with a traumatic backstory, which sells the not-so-great message of every trauma survivor turning into a crazy serial killer, which, while horrible and pretty unrealistic, still manages to be a sadly pervasive and commonplace trope in modern fiction. The author can't decide whether he wants Yuno to be a tragic, naive girl in need of saving, or a cruel, manipulative, and jaded individual who lost the capacity to care for anyone's interests but her own. And in trying to strike a weird middle ground between the two, she simply becomes the worst of both worlds, a scatterbrained mess of a character with no self-worth who bows her head unquestioningly to a boy she abuses, who tries to isolate and possess him while also begging him to use her. She's the clearest narrative sign of a fundamentally warped view of people, encapsulated in one extremely poorly written, nigh compromisingly transparent caricature of how older men see younger women. Speaking of a lack of respect for women, let's talk about the weird fanservice in this show. And no, I don't mean to imply all fanservice is in extremely poor taste, otherwise I wouldn't be able to defend my taste for nonsense like Kill la Kill, which is objectively full of crude fanservice bait, but still has an excellent story. No, the fanservice in Mirai Nikki is oftentimes just insatiably grody to the point where it gets really, really uncomfortable. It just feels gross. It leaves you feeling like you just gotta shower sometimes after watching it. And most, if not all of the time, the fanservice doesn't actually add anything to the story or even much to the episode itself. It's not only weird, but it just wastes your time, and it doesn't really help that a lot of the fanservice is centered around characters it really should be making older if they wanted to do that. 14-year-old Yuno gets multiple instances parading her around in underwear, showing her breasts bounce up and down and getting into awkward sexual situations for comedic relief, which made me cringe back into myself so hard I felt like I was getting a sudden onset of reverse scoliosis. Not to mention a majority of it is either in poor taste or just weird. Gratuitous titty shot of a girl handcuffed in a dungeon, Yuno's bra floating away in the pool, two different female characters getting... Let's save that for its own section, actually. Yuki's mom encouraging her 14-year-old son really overbearingly and creepily to have sex with his also 14-year-old girlfriend, having like two separate scenes dedicated to people getting awkward about pissing in front of each other? Oh my god, Esno, are you into water sports? Is that why you wrote this in? Why would you keep talking about pee stuff? It's really weird, man. Speaking of weird things that make no sense, boy does this show have a lot of those things. This varies from just plain inconsistent characterization to just baffling decisions made by the characters themselves, or even just poor logic at points. Point is, this sucker's all over the map with inconsistent internal logic. And that's not a good look, especially for a series where tactics are so heavily emphasized in its death game setting. This can range from very minor things to very major things. Here's a minor example. Yuki using his future diary to cheat on a test in class, which begs the question of how his teacher doesn't just see him reading off of his phone behind his desk. It's not really that hard to see that. People got caught looking at their phones at my school incredibly easy. We had to figure out like practical human Rube Goldberg machines to operate our phones indiscriminately and undetected. I once used to text people by hitting the keyboard keys on my flip phone through the fabric of my jacket pocket. Mechanics aren't always clear either, like Yuki's diary warns him of incoming hazards to his alive status marked by a dead end, but a lot of those entries are phrased in a very immediate sense? Things like, this classroom right next to me exploded and I died, or I got stabbed to death and died, will appear as entries in his diary to clue him in, but Yuki's diary entries were always said to supposedly reflect something he would have potentially noted in his diary if he weren't futurely inclined in self-writing. It creates a bit of confusion there, when I'm wondering exactly how he would have had the opportunity to type something like, oh no, I've been decapitated, if he's being decapitated. Speaking of Yuki, he in particular is the subject of a lot of just plain foolishness, from trying to use his diary to find the bathroom in Yuno's house when he could have just asked. which incidentally is only used as an excuse for him to discover her parents' corpses to, again, him hearing from her directly that she's hiding things from him, but not actually asking her anything else after that. He trusts people he obviously shouldn't. He doesn't trust only the people he most often obviously should. And again, everyone loves him for some reason, which remains an indecipherable mystery to me. Then you get to some of the more extreme examples, which just really take the piss, like Hojo Reisuke. Just Hojo Reisuke in general. He's a 5-year-old boy, who is also a diary user, who Yuki and Yuno have to fight in episode 7. The idea of a toddler being a user is an interesting concept at the very least, but the intrigue of this concept completely flies out the window when he acts like nothing like a 5-year-old would actually act. For one, he knows how to get a hold of poison, weaponry, and he knows how to use it. He knows how to make an electrical trap. He knows where and how to get nerve gas. The only explanation the show seemingly offers for his incredible intellect is him having a lot of time alone due to neglect from his parents who are always fighting with each other. But when you see a potential world near the end of the show where Reisuke's parents didn't die and lived happily, he's nowhere near this level of apparent intelligence, which implies he somehow developed these smarts in a relatively short period of time, which is just really asking a lot of me to suspend my disbelief for. A lot of relatively convenient things crop up in the plot too, which is just indicative of pretty lazy planning all things considered. There are endless amount of coincidence meetings, Kosuke gets a subordinate diary in episode 14 from 8th, whose diary acts like a server, which serves to help him in a dire situation, but neither of the two had ever met before, and it seemingly isn't ever explained why she would actually help him. Yuno and Yuki drive a car, despite being 14 and somehow are adept enough to have a high-stakes shootout on a highway. 11th has a signal jammer installed on his car, specifically to combat 8th's server diary capabilities, which is not only a weird car upgrade, but seems counterintuitive to his desired use of the server diary later. And speaking of counterintuitive, what gives with his diary being clearly OP? It's a pretty clear lack of fairness on part of the other users for his to be, like, by design, better than theirs. But hey, you know, a lot of things just happen the way they do in this show with little to no explanation given, and if you want an explanation, you're an idiot. And Sakai Esuno personally would allow you to get hit by a bus if he had the opportunity to pull you out of the way as it was oncoming, because then you'd stop asking questions. There are so many contrived plot points that kind of just happen, that turning it into a drinking game would leave you dead on the carpet within a few episodes max. And I'm not going to go into each one in detail because we'd be here for ages, if so, but I think it's important to at least touch on the wildly inconsistent decisions this narrative makes, both for what seem like convenience and for just full-on nonsense, inexplicable motives entirely. Why add the deduction angle of the diary user's identities if revealing their identities didn't actually end up playing that big of a part in the actual show? Most of the diary users either directly reveal themselves to each other, or they just kind of suddenly show up. The most clear deciphering of someone's identity happens when Yuki finds out who 11th is, but all he does to figure that out is sit in City Hall for 5 days straight and allow his diary to, wow, huh, go figure, do the job for him. Yuki's mom is mysteriously absent most of the time due to working as a game developer, but is also apparently fine with leaving her 14-year-old son home alone most of the time, and uncomfortably fine with the idea of him having sex under their roof with his similarly underage girlfriend. And yeah, I know that's because they need Yuki to have an excuse to use his house as a home base and be there with Yuno a lot, but that's the thing. It's contrived. It's a contrived reason. It doesn't hold up under scrutiny. The same way Reisuke being a mega genius doesn't. The same reason why it's weird that Yuno goes into the random one-time only Arkham Asylum Zen state in episode 7 when she's trying to figure out where he's gone. The way she somehow just psychically interprets his plan from doing that despite having zero actual idea of what he's going to do. It's all for convenience. None of it holds up logically, and all of it is difficult to take at face value because of this. If none of the events feel natural or believable, you're not really pulled in by the drama they attempt to create, and if you're not invested in the impact of a story beat, then the story is failing to do its job. And these are far from the only examples. Characters disregard basic common sense conclusions all the time to give the plot leeway to capitalize on that. No human person could be as stupid as some of these people tend to be, but because the plot needs them to, They are. Yuno is a great example of this, because at times, she's extremely calculated, notices the smallest details, and is generally a strategic genius. But at other times, she's extremely inept, takes over-explanation to grasp even the most simple concepts, and doesn't have any idea how to take no for an answer. Yuki sees how she acts, and yet he keeps staying with her and tolerating her behavior anyway. Not because anyone in their right mind would put up with what she does, but because the plot needs him to fall for her, despite never establishing good enough reasons for him to do so, other than, she's cute! Oh, and the girl in Yuki's flashback he's got the hots for looks exactly like a younger version of his mom. Are we gonna talk about that? Are we gonna talk about that? Okay, so let's give myself a break for a little bit. Let's talk about a small, tiny sliver of this show that I actually liked. Uryu Minane is the purple-haired terrorist bomber who's introduced in episode 2, and boy, is she a lot of fun. She often delivers the most level-headed lines in the entire show, and when she's not dishing out worthwhile advice, she's yelling at the characters who bring my piss to a boil, and I can respect that. She doesn't let Yuki off the hook for being so whiny, and she calls Yuno for what she is. She gets her eye stabbed out, but then she gets a glass eye and an eye patch and trucks on to become one of the final few contenders of the game. She has extreme expertise in combat, expert strategy skills, and plays to win, doing anything and everything to get around. While she is ruthless, though, she also has a sense of standards here and there that, while inconsistent, provides much more of a human side to her than we ever get for someone like Yuno. She genuinely cares about people around her, and she doesn't single-mindedly focus on one person alone. Even when Yuki becomes arguably the biggest piece of garbage in the entire series, she takes some level of mercy on him because his childish self-pity reminds her of her own naivety when she was younger. Not only that, her backstory isn't actually that bad. An orphan left a victim of war when religious conflicts broke out in the Middle East, she grew up on the streets for survival, digging for scraps, and fervently hated religion with every fiber of her being. Consequently, when she's dragged into the game, she fights for godhood to acquire the chance to wipe out godhood in its entirety, hating the concept to its core. It's a very simple but effective motive, which makes all of her actions feel grounded in a coherent sense of determined efforts, and her genuine pathos throughout it makes her all the more endearing as a character because of that. Also, she's just badass. And when she said this to Kurisu after being hounded by him on the phone, I think we were all glad she did.
You double-cross me, you're dead!
Better.
Of course, as great a character as Minane is, it wouldn't be Mirai Nikki if my expectations weren't killed and trampled over somehow. And that comes into play with police officer Nishijima. Okay, so Nishijima is a police officer in the show, and he's honestly, well, a bit of a bland addition to the secondary character roster. He shows up quite a bit, but until he starts getting more screen time, he's barely recognizable, and by the time you do start to recognize him, it's not for any particular personality strengths he has. He's not terrible, but he's certainly pretty boring. Almost about as flat as Yuki is, in fact. He's pretty honest and polite, he works pretty close to the letter of the law, he assists in some game events later on. That's about it as far as his personality goes. The only other reason people remember him is because he develops a romantic relationship with Minane, which is just about as out of nowhere and weirdly sudden as it sounds. The first time they ever meet, the show plays up laughs about them having awkward romantic tensions, but in doing so, constantly bends Minane's previously established personality traits to fit around awkward, flirty banter. They often show her getting flustered around him, but nothing about her core personality traits in scenes without him indicate that she's susceptible to anything like that. And more often than not, it ends up making Minane feel like she's an entirely different character when she shares a scene with Nishijima, which, combined with a pretty rushed pace, makes their relationship all the more confusing in a narrative sense. After very few encounters where they help each other in a business-like manner, he suddenly proposes to her and later on in the same episode dies, which seemingly changes Minane's entire personality in one fell swoop and turns her into a loyal maiden who just wanted a man to save her and take her away from the bad terrorist life. Which I don't think I should have to explain how that's pretty dumb, but it's pretty dumb. I mean, really, you have to wonder why Sno even writes crap like this. Why is he just so bad at writing decent female characters without someone ruining it? Yeah, this really is unavoidable, honestly. It crops up so often and uncomfortably in this show that I think it's just kind of an elephant in the room that needs addressing because, wow, that is a big elephant and this room is small and we probably need to do something about it. Maybe tell that elephant to please go somewhere else. Now, for the record, I want to say that an unfortunate amount of the media we like has some level, either negligible or not so negligible, of misogyny. It's just something that's really pervasive in our society, so it sucks, but there's very little avoiding it. That being said, I can get past misogyny in media, usually if it's so slight that I can comfortably try to at least ignore it. But with something like Mirai Nikki, that is nigh impossible, because a lot of narrative shortcomings in this show result directly from what seem like an implicit lack of understanding as to what women are like. For one, there's Yuno and her aforementioned hysterical personality centered solely on a boy she's obsessed with, which would be enough on its own if it weren't also for her blind subservience and willingness to be used by him being actively flaunted as if they're great signs of devotion, when in reality they're extremely unhealthy behaviors. The fan service contributes a lot in how this kind of thing is detected too, because while it's easy to point out objectification in the case of boob shots, for example, it's the context and seeming lack of tastefulness and when it's appropriate to do these things that really drives this point home to me. Let's take the topless shots, yes, plural, for example. Yuno is shown topless more than once. She's a child, that is really weird. Meine is shown topless a couple of times. One isn't too bad, but the other has her chained up in a basement by a weirdo in spandex, so that's a hard no on that one. Hinata's hips and panties are shown off in her first proper appearance due to a really stupid, contrived accident gag, which really doesn't give off the idea that she's got a lot of the writer's respect. Similarly, later we get a topless scene of her and one fully nude scene of her in the hot springs, and she's the same age as Yuno is. Tsubaki and I are really the ones who get the worst of it, though, because of their extremely uncomfortable forms of specific poor taste tragic backstories. And before this part transitions to the next part where we talk about that, I just want to warn you, it will involve the topic of sexual assault scenes. I'm not going to go into extreme detail or talk for very long about it, but if you want to skip to the next section after, here's a time code, and if you're watching a live premiere, just pause it until then, and pick back up live when enough time has passed. I'll give you a minute to choose and do as you may. Sadly, there is more than one of these in Mirai Nikki. Two, if we're being exact, and one that almost leads into something, but wow, are all of them bad. It's like they always say, if you can write a tragic backstory and you can use anything to get the point across that's not rape, you probably should not use rape. Because using rape as a plot device can be seriously tone-deaf when handled in the wrong way. And all too often it is. That's not to say rape can never be used in a story, but you better have a damn good reason to subject your audience to such an uncomfortable and oftentimes extremely touchy subject if you do. And Mirai Nikki uses it to excruciatingly stupid and tasteless effect both times it does. The first example is with Tsubaki Kasugano, the sixth diary owner and high priestess of the Omikata religious cult. On the surface, she appears polite and extremely friendly, talking very naturally to Yukiteru and befriending him and asking him to guard her for a spell while she's in danger. However, after a while, her backstory is revealed, and so too are her inner demons. Tsubaki is shown to be bitter, angry, emotional, to despise the world, her religion, and her own life, to be manipulative, sadistic, and willing to assault others to upset people close to them, and bend them to submit. So why is she like this? The show posits it's because, when she was younger, her parents died in a tragic accident, leaving her in a vulnerable position to be taken advantage of by the religion's members, who made her an involuntary sex slave for ages afterward. I don't think I need to explain how insulting it is to depict a survivor of sexual abuse as a sadistic monster who only wishes to make others suffer similarly, but it is especially disgusting to depict her trying to deliberately get Yuno gang-raped to lure Yuki to her room, to depict Yuno's clothes getting ripped off when she's, again, 14, and even more so, to show really intensely provocative shots of Tsubaki during the flashbacks of her being raped. It's so exceptionally cruel and disgustingly exploitative that it makes me shiver just thinking about it. They have Tsubaki imply multiple times that when she lost her virginity, she lost her virtue, equating the two, which has some deeply unfortunate roots in the fetishization of purity or innocence correlated directly with virginity, which itself has some very troubling implications, considering Tsubaki is similarly 14 and likely even younger in the flashbacks when she's assaulted. The way they defeat her, by the way? Oh, get this nonsense. When Tsubaki was being raped all the time, She only derived a sliver of joy from a ball she was given by her late dead mother, but she lost it at some point during that time and couldn't find it, leaving her with nothing to distract her from the pain. Yuki just happens to find it under one of the houses and distracts her by throwing the ball to get her attention, then destroys her diary. Asuno, we need to talk about this. Why do you hate women so much? And then there's Ai, whose rape backstory isn't quite so hyperbolically awful, but is still pretty contrived and bad. Her girl classmates hate her for basically no reason, and write her a fake note to go to an abandoned warehouse and get raped by some older male classmates waiting to ambush her. She's shown afterward wearing her boyfriend's jacket after he came to rescue her, and during the dramatic emotional scene it falls off and they show us her bare chest for fan service, which really is not at all an appropriate time for that. Also, really the only reason she was even given this backstory in the first place seems to just be for the sake of giving her boyfriend man pain about it, which, like, great. It really does boggle the mind how they thought these bits were acceptable, but really the whole story seems so messily strung along that I doubt much planning went into it at all, and boy do the abundant episode cliffhangers really show that. The most empty promise of a bad show is to keep tricking you into thinking it'll get better, that something big will happen, that all the time you wasted watching this garbage is going to actually turn out to have been worth it all along. It's a staple of Moffat, it's practically the narrative force of the MCU at this point, and it is pervasive throughout this entire show from basically beginning to end. Logically, you should know that every time you hit one of these stupid, hackneyed cliffhangers, that nothing good is going to come from it. The problem is, even if you know that, your brain is already set on knowing. It just can't leave the box unticked. Logically, you should know that this show sucks by now, by the time you've hit episode 18. But if you've gotten this far, guess what? You're gonna finish it. And you're gonna hate yourself the entire time you're doing it, but you won't be able to stop, because it's a sunk cost at this point. You wasted too much of your time to be above wasting a little more of it. And damn it, you're at least gonna see how it all ends. And is it worth it? No. It's not. Hardly ever does one of these cliffhangers ever deliver interestingly, either. Another tip from the Moffat school of writing they took, I suppose. Oh no, Yuno's doing crazy shit again, I wonder if she'll- Oh wait, she does basically what I expected. Oh wait, oh my god, she's gassing them! Are they gonna- Oh no, they're fine actually, they got out. Oh my god, Yuki's finally leaving her! He's back with her in less than an episode and a half. Oh my god, he's really leaving her this time! Oh no, wait, he doesn't actually care about the strange human remains in her backyard, and he decided he doesn't care about that anymore. How am I to care about where the story goes if the story itself doesn't appear to give a rat's ass where it's headed at any given time? It builds up these intensely dramatic cliffhangers and then makes them either completely pointless in seconds or entirely useless within mere episodes of each other. At a point, you stop worrying about what any of these apparent twists mean or are because of how wildly often the status quo shifts and goes back to the same old with barely any effort at all. Speaking of which... Mirai Nikki has some of the weirdest character development I have ever seen. And calling it development really is just flat-out generous of me to do in the first place, because it really more closely resembles the character suddenly being replaced with completely different characters who have their name and face. It's the crabgrass delusion of character writing, except not, like, actually intentionally playing off of that delusion, because, you know, that might actually be, like, clever or something. But Nezumi, what about how you know- Not yet! Please! Live a little bit longer in the sweet- sweet painless moments I have before I have to talk about that. Anyway, I already talked about how this pans out with characters like Meine, but it even happens to characters as central as Yuki, and boy, does it make him even more insufferable as a result. Around the end of episode 18, due to basically contrivances, Yuki's parents both die, and then despite having very little physical training of any kind from Meine for like a week, he's able to take out like 8 military-grade dudes with only a knife, and he's super badass? As a objectively physically weak 14-year-old boy who has spent 99% of his screen time up until this point just crying and letting other people fight his battles, like, what? Then in episode 19, he just becomes an entirely different character for a bit, being billed like he's some big, strong, bishonen dreamy boy who swaddles Yuno in his arms into the meeting with the other diary users and reveals his grand master deductive skills of finding out who the mayor was. And not only was it all off-screen, but it wasn't even impressive at all how he did it. It was just kind of extremely lame. Even when he's acting cool, he can't actually be cool. He has Yuno write a script for him to have an epic speech. How incredibly stupid is that?
I can't stand this anymore. Please, Travis. I know these past few months have been wonderful out here in the blazing heat of the Texas countryside. I am just your loyal best friend and yellow Labrador. So if I may trouble you with one final request, I have been bitten by a rabid wolf. I'm afraid my mind is not what it once was. I am seething with animal hatred that won't go away until this stupid anime is destroyed. And because it will not leave this world, I must go first. It is the only way to prevent a bloodbath. You understand, Travis. You always did understand me. You know how I like to steal meat. Remember those days? Anyway, I suppose this is it. Don't hesitate now. This will hurt me a lot more than it hurts you in the long run, frankly. Pull the trigger, Travis. It's okay.
Anyway, yeah, it's very inconsistent. Just really takes you out of the experience.
I have the power of God and anime on my side!
Wait, the-
This show really wants me to feel sorry for Yuno Gasai. And I feel somewhat bad saying this, but actually, no, wait, I don't. She's awful. And I really don't feel sorry for her at all. Yuno has an abuse backstory, one involving her parents doing really awful things, yada yada yada, bing bong boom, and then she's crazy and super violent and has no regard for other people's feelings. First of all, that's not how that works. The mentally ill are not ethicless murderers thirsty for blood. Second of all, the only reason she apparently attaches so hard to Yuki is because at one point during the height of her abuse, she weirdly came out of nowhere and offered the idea of marriage to him, and being awkward, he didn't outright refuse and simply told her they'd have to wait until they got older. That is it. And third of all, that still does not justify the multitude of extremely awful things she does both to him and to anyone in general. She has a blatant disregard for lives that aren't her own or Yuki's. She lies to get her way. She manipulates and isolates Yuki repeatedly to the point of making him codependent on her when initially he wanted nothing to do with her at all. She makes constant and concentrated romantic and sexual advances on him without permission until he relents and pretends to want it, and then eventually until he thinks he does, which comes similarly out of nowhere, much like most of the development in the show. I really don't care what her backstory pans out to look like, considering that all of this, her actions are still not excusable because of it, and she never regrets or denounces these decisions either. She only ever tries to write them off or hide them, and she never takes responsibility for them if she gives enough of a care to actually even admit they were wrong in the first place, or not have the intention to gaslight Yuki about it. And again, all of this over a passing conversation. They make this moment of their promise out to be so important. It gets brought up exhaustively. It gets referred to exhaustively. And it's even used for dramatic visual purposes more than once. And it's such a terrible, terrible reason to provide for her obsession with him. I realize that abuse victims do tend to attach pretty fiercely to anyone who shows them kindness. Trust me, I know that from experience. But to suggest that such a minute interaction really caused her to be this freakishly devoted to someone, and yet so oddly simultaneously disregardant of their happiness in any conceivable way, is completely beyond my suspension of disbelief, and worthlessly melodramatic in assuming that that would make me see their love as legitimate, because it doesn't, especially not coming from somebody who drugged and kidnapped her boyfriend. Part 14. Wait, she drugged and kidnapped him? Are you kidding me? Oh yeah. You didn't think I forgot about this part, did you? No, I just wanted to hold off so I could give it its own section, because I am filled with so much spite for it in particular. So near the end of episode 12, Yuki starts getting some stupid ideas about actually getting serious with Yuno, an idea seemingly motivated purely in the last episode or two to go from actual fear to actual love, purely because they attended a fake wedding together once. That, do people even do that? Is that like a Japan thing, or is that like just total BS as it sounds? Somebody chime in the comments and let me know. I'm actually like genuinely curious about this. Anyway, It's really inorganic and lazy and comes out of pretty much left field, considering how she's treated him and how scared of her he's been this entire time. So, yeah. Anyway, they decide to go stargaze, and wouldn't you know, Yuno decides it's a great and totally acceptable plan to lure him to the train ride, drug him to sleep, take him to a remote ghost town, put him in the basement of a building tied to a chair where he can't move at all, and rig the entire building with excessively medieval death traps to kill any of his friends that come to potentially look for him. When Hinata and the gang show up to try and save Yuki, she literally locks them in a room and tries to gas them to death. And not only that, she doesn't even wait for them to arrive on their own. If it weren't bad enough already, she deliberately lures them to the correct building by taking Yuki's phone and texting them under the false pretense that he sent it himself, which means she wasn't even trying to kill them to keep them away. She deliberately lured them out to kill them on purpose, all because, again, they're Yuki's friends, and nobody but her is allowed to spend any waking moment around him, I suppose. Good thing Mom was lucky, but you know, yeah, she wouldn't have been if, you know, had changed her mind on the flip of a dime. She brings him food on a tray in her underwear while he's dead-eyed and so traumatized that he won't even eat. She says the reason she did this was to maintain their relationship and safety, but that makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. They all make it out in one piece, thankfully, but not before she firstly makes Yuki humiliate himself by pissing through a hose that she hooks up to his crotch, which, again, seriously, SNO, what is your thing with piss, man? It's really starting to get disturbingly recurrent. And secondly, she literally tries to trick Kosuka into a bum deal and kill him with arrows when his back is turned, which incidentally is completely stupid when they have her launch into a pretty exceedingly coherent speech about her clever strategic machinations, but then next minute be so completely oblivious to how awful she is for doing any of this. Forget selective memory, she has selective intelligence. And I would say that Yuki finally gets some intelligence here by telling her to screw off and leaving her behind, but within an episode and a half, he just completely gives up on holding this against her and it's dropped as a topic for the rest of the series. So then what was the point? Was it to give Akise long enough to dig up the corpses at Yuno's house? You could have, I don't know, somehow worked this into a more important plot event that actually went somewhere and didn't make Yuki look like a bigger idiot than you already have. No, instead we get the absolute pinnacle top of the charts, height of Yuno's abusive behavior on full display and get it completely swept under the rug not even two episodes later. What was the point of this entire subplot? It takes up like two or three full episodes and it goes nowhere. Let me reiterate, she drugged Yuki, dragged him to a remote ghost town, squirreled him away into a terrible dark basement, strapped him to a chair, and then tried to murder his only friends with gas and arrows. And if this was supposed to be a distraction for Yuno, why still give Akise enough time to show up and lord her error over her, and have that not go much of anywhere for a long time? Why not save his investigation for later, and attach it to an actual worthwhile plot point? Or maybe this was supposed to create a divide between Yuki and Yuno in the story. That would make sense. Or it would if he didn't get over it like it was no big deal later and treat the whole thing as a footnote. Not only does this little arc make no sense, but it also wasted my time. And not only that, but it goes to make the continuous foundation of Yuki and Yuno's relationship all the more unrealistic. Why does Yuki trust her about anything at this point? Much less get over this incident fast enough to then be fully devoted to her and be a hyper-competent super badass all of a sudden within the span of 5 episodes. Oh wait, never mind, I'm giving him too much credit, because if he's still not letting Yuno do all of his fighting, he's letting his phone do deduction work for him, or sitting around on his hands waiting and calling it strategy, or waiting until Meine and Co. get completely screwed in a terrible, violent slaughter of a battle, only to walk up as they're getting killed and take the remaining spoils for himself, because seriously, dude, can you do anything for yourself? You can't even stay mad about being drugged, kidnapped, and tied to a chair, so apparently now I have to do that for you. I wasn't sure where else to put this, but it's another pit stop we have to make before we reach the end of our insufferable hate train, because boy, it is a doozy. Aru Akise, the resident Kaoru Nagisa of this series, because I guess we really needed one. Akise is a decent enough character in his own right, I suppose. He has some kind of dunderheaded moments for supposedly being as sharp-witted as he is, but overall he's not one of the characters that makes me wish I hadn't got out of bed in the morning. But there's one thing that becomes increasingly and obnoxiously apparent about Akise from basically his first appearance onward. He is extremely stereotypically gay. Like, extremely. He passively flirts with Yuki for almost, like, ever from minute one of being around him.
and immediately draws the ire of Yuno for it. He constantly makes passes at Yuki, gets close to him, does practically anything to keep him safe and try to get him away from Yuno. But here's the thing. It's really forced. And no, when I say forced, I'm not trying to sound like a whiny internet troll who just can't stand gay ships for some reason. That's not my problem. I'm saying this being fully confident in that assessment, that Akise's love for Yuki, if you could even call it that, is extremely out of left field and laid on extremely thick from the moment they first share screen time together. Akise barely even knows Yuki before becoming enamored with him romantically, which, number one, isn't less extremely unrealistic feeling coming from a guy as it does coming from Yuno, because really, guys, Mr. Personality here? Really? And number two, there's really no build-up to it, aside from Akise making a lot of strangely homoerotic passes at Yuki that are played for really poor-taste laughs, and then him all of a sudden deciding he's gay enough for Yuki to will himself to stop being killed by Deus. Oh, right, did I mention that Akise is a conduit of Deus's will used to spy on the living world as an outside man? If you're thinking, wow, that came out of nowhere and made no sense, then you'd be absolutely correct. But we'll be coming back to this point later, so tuck that in your cap for now. Point is, after he runs off to save Yuki, he has one on-screen super gay moment by kissing him, and Yuno immediately decapitates him, so SNO really respecting the gays out here, huh? No, instead, we gotta make room for the healthy, pure, heterosexual lovebirds that are definitely in a healthy relationship that is both well-developed and understandable. I definitely don't think they're a horrible match or two incoherently naive, stupid, horny teenagers who don't know literally anything. Oh my god, when did they decide they were in love? I mean, I know when Yuno decided they were in love. With how much she talks about it, you'd practically think she was in love with Yuki in the womb. But when did Yuki decide to just forgive her for the whole Uncle Yuno's naked potato basement fiasco? Alright, he just forgot about it, like an episode and a half before going back to using her as a meat shield during combat because he sucks and can't get anything done on his own. Well, good thing he finally takes charge and grows a pair for a change. Sure, his character development is so radically out of nowhere that it doesn't even feel like the same guy, and his cool transformation just feels more completely obnoxious and self-important than anything else. But hey, I'm at least sure he'll get better now. Oh, wait, I hate him more now. I hate both of them more now. Wow, I didn't even think it was possible, but somehow they did it. They team up with 8th and her kids to try to defeat 11th, but then it turns out the whole plan was just a giant hoax to turn on 8th and kill her, which really doesn't sell me on their status as righteous protagonists when Yuki kills everyone who trusted him to do right by them. Of course, he says that when he becomes God, he intends to bring everybody back to life, but first problem, that still doesn't exactly make his wanton murdering any less completely awful, and second problem, we'll get to that in a minute. At this point, Yuki officially stops questioning anything Yuno says and does basically everything she wants, which is one of the worst possible decisions to ever make. He hangs back intentionally to let everything go to hell for Meine and co, and then waltzes right up to take the spoils. Of course, Meine delivers some brief form of catharsis by threatening to kill him, but it doesn't last long because they ruin it by giving her a soft spot for him, while understandable for her character, I guess, is still pretty misplaced in this scenario, and clearly acts as a convenient way for Yuki to gun her down. She says they're the same as each other, but while Meine was naive and irresponsible looking for her parents to return when she was like 5, she wasn't 14 like he is, and sure, you could say, well, 14 is still pretty young and dumb. And yeah, it is, but he should at least have some spine and better sense by the time he's that old. But no, doing either of those things would be responsible, wouldn't it? And guess what Yuki lacks to an extreme extent for the rest of the show's final act? Good lord, you just can't get this kid to admit to doing anything wrong. It's either a misunderstanding, or it's Yuno's fault, or it's the only option he has, or blah 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 blah. Yuki does some pretty inexcusable crap in the final act of this show, and the only reason he's able to stand by it is because he thinks he can resurrect everyone if he just wins the game and becomes God. But here's the thing, he can't. Oh, yeah, that's another twist. And of course, as soon as Yuki's friends tell him this, he calls them all liars and kills them by shooting them to death. Yuno tries to convince him that they're all traitors by calling and saying Akise is killing her, when he's really halfway up the road and she stabbed herself. But no, yeah, clearly Yuno is the trustworthy one here. Between your friends who have always had your back, always worked for your best interest, saved you from a literal basement strapped to a chair, and the girl who strapped you to said chair,
These guys, the only friends who have ever given a damn about you, versus the girl who has lied to you countless times, hurt you over and over again, constantly shown herself to be a pathological liar with a history of using violence to get her way, and you kill your friends for lying about her. I would call him a piece of idiot garbage, but Kosaka basically does that for me, following by punching him in the face, which is cathartic and all, but it still ends with Yuki shooting him, so that doesn't really warm my heart at all. Anyway, screw Yuki Teru Amino. That's all there really is to say on the matter. Seriously, am I supposed to like him? Deus Ex Machina is a pretty crappy god. No, I won't bring up the fact that he even needs a successor in the first place, because, well, that is something worth making a small note of, I suppose. It's still ultimately irrelevant, considering that if that weren't the case, the series wouldn't exist anyway. It's like if you ask why Light Yagami didn't just put the Death Note down and walk away. Well, yeah, that'd be better for everyone, wouldn't it? But then we'd have no show, Harold. Now, my problem with Deus stems from his oftentimes completely inconsistent level of power. Sometimes he seems like he's all-knowing and omniscient. But then there's this whole twist about Akise being an extension of his being. Yeah. Didn't think I forgot to come back to that one, did you? Well, I didn't. So, okay, let's talk about this. Deus says Akise was created by him to act as a man on the ground, to observe through. First of all, let's start with the first point of contention I have with this bit. Akise acts incredibly surprised that Deus created him, and this is treated as something exceptionally special. Now, maybe I'm overthinking this, but is it not natural to assume that God, in a story, if he conducts the machinations of the world and gave it life in the first place, would also have created all of the humans? If he didn't, where did they come from? Who did create them? And why is it so unprecedented for God to have this ability? Furthermore, if they have powers exceeding that of Deus's, then who is this person? Who would sit in a higher position than God himself? Second of all, why would Deus need Akise on the ground to observe through him? He seems to show a fairly acute awareness of many things happening in the human world. He doesn't seem to be directly observing through Akise or otherwise, but then suddenly he needs a viewport? What about when Murmur shows him things that appear to be on a giant holographic screen? Can he not create those whenever he wants instead of creating a human spyglass in Akise? And really, he's God. You mean to tell me that with the powers of godhood, you can't even observe the world you created? It's one thing to drop the bombshell that gods can't bring the dead back to life, but it's another matter entirely to make him unable to do even the most basic of tasks to the point where he has to create an appointed human peephole through which to view everything from. And none of this really even ends up going anywhere anyway, because Akise no longer being needed by Deus comes out of absolutely nowhere and has no logical placement or application to the story at hand, other than having Akise say he loves Yuki to conclude that he has free will, and then Deus is like, oh, okay, never mind, if you have free will, then I guess I won't kill you for no reason. What was the point? Oh, it was to confirm that Akise was gay in the scene before he got decapitated for it. Oh, okay. The final arc of the series is infuriatingly stupid, and not just stupid, but much more left field than the show has ever been up until this point. Throwing out wild last-minute twists like nobody's business and hoping desperately that some of them land. Spoilers, they don't. I mean, okay, maybe that's unfair. I mean, I'm sure some people enjoyed these twists, enjoyed the show even, and I don't begrudge those people or think that they're stupid. If they got something out of it, then I'm happy they could see something I didn't, though frankly I'm a little concerned that did they see what I did? Okay, anyway. So Murmur betrays Deus in a left-field move numero uno, right before we get a long, drawn-out bit of Yuki and Yuno spending time together as the last diary holders on Earth. It doesn't really sit well with or interest me at all, because by this point I'm so fueled by seething hatred every time I see either of them that I could power an entire city with the steam emitting from my ears. Yuno cries a river because Yuki doesn't seem to completely trust her still, but why would he? He's a moron for even wanting to be near her at all after what she did to him. But he does. So frankly, I'd take what you can get at this point. You made your bed, now lay in it.
Oh god, no, not like that.
So Yuki and Yuno consummate their relationship. Seriously, why not have just made them like 18-year-old high school seniors or something if you really wanted to draw this much weird horny art? You had the power to do so and you failed to even use it even remotely responsibly. As soon as Yuki mentions dead people not being able to come back to life right after this, though, she admits she lied to him, and even then, he still doesn't give that much of a care about it anymore. Like, yeah, her lying to him about all that all along? Yeah, that was totally fine. The fact that this notion led to him killing his friends when they kept telling him the truth repeatedly, both about that and Yuno lying to him, doesn't even get brought up. The only thing he's torn up about is that he thinks being God wouldn't be worth it if Yuno wasn't with him, which is horrendous, considering at this point I think you have to actively try to be stupid enough to not see her as awful. Anyway, before Yuki can smooth out this compromising information out of his brain, the plot catches up with them out of nowhere and reveals Yuno to have actually been a Yuno from a different timeline all along. That she actually won the game before and became God and then went back in time and killed her in an alternate timeline self and took her place to join Yuki here. The first time she planned to fake their double suicide and bring him back when she became God, but then learned that you couldn't bring people back, so she just did this. It's what feels like would be a decent twist in an otherwise better show, but it just comes with so little build and sprinkles of really stupid, heavy-handed, random foreshadowing that it just doesn't really engage as much and leaves you feeling blindsided, not in a good way. The final act really does just come completely out of nowhere, and Yuki acting all self-righteous about what Yuno did is infuriating, considering at this point he's barely in a position to act like he's any better than she is. But no time for ruminating on the consequences of one's actions. It's time for the completely unearned dramatic climax of the series. This is where things get really blisteringly incoherent really fast, so hang tight. It turns out, Murmur screwed up the game and usurped Deus because she was actually the universe one Murmur who answered to Yuno, who was that universe's god because she won. She came back with Yuno and trapped U2 Murmur to take her place. Meine comes back because, yeah, remember that poignant death scene that approached actually resembling a well-put-together moment? Well, never mind. Deus saved her last second to have her show up and literally be a Deus Ex Machina. Yuki's one true desire is to save Yuno, which would make a cool idea for the climax, but it just completely falls flat before it even gets off the ground because of how incredibly unlikable they are, both as people and to each other. Yuki saves U3 Yuno from being killed by U1 Yuno as the classroom bit gets hammered in a little more, reminding you of how stupid it was the first time. Yuno admits her love for Yuki was entirely superficial, which would make a good admittance if Yuki didn't immediately follow that up with, okay, we were codependent, but I wasn't just using her. Like, when did that stop being a thing? When did that love become genuine? When you started acting like a cool guy? Because, call me crazy, but I think you were just horny, dude. Yuki volunteers to let Yuno just kill him, but then she stabs herself and dies, and he wins, and he becomes god of the crapsack world, and he's miserable forever. Meanwhile, in Universe 3, things got fixed with Yuno and her parents, and all the commotion somehow caused a domino effect of making all the diary users in that universe somehow get happy endings after all, because their bad backstories were averted, and Mare 11 decides the game is stupid and sucks, and he doesn't like the idea anymore, and that gets called off. God Yuki lays in the world void for a millennia, just sulking, until Yuno suddenly appears to visit him and the show ends. Woo! Oh, wait, there's the epilogue OVA left. I'm conflicted about this thing. I saw the full anime itself years ago, originally, but I was so put off by the ending and really the whole cumulative experience in retrospect that I just didn't bother going to watch the OVA. So seeing it recently while rewatching the show to make this video, I saw it for the first time. And on one hand, does it improve upon the ending? Yeah, somewhat, but it really is pretty stupid, and it really doesn't fix any of the problems I had with the show itself beyond providing an explanation as to what that last cliffhanger was all about. And even then, the explanation is kind of completely incoherent. It starts with U1 Murmur eating dead U1 Yuno to store her memories when she dies, but then she's taken into custody by U3 Murmur, who leaves promptly. U3 Yuno, meanwhile, gets to be friends with Akise's crew, but gets weird flashes of her U1 memories. U3 Yuno tries to get into Deus's world, but U3 Murmur tries to keep her out, until she's stalled by U2 Meine, who comes to help because she's bored or something. Oh yeah, earlier, by the way, Deus is like, hey, Meine, you want to become new god? And Meine's like, no. Anyway, bye! Akise tries to stall Yuno next because he still seems to hold a grudge, which is also confusing if he's supposed to be from this new universe, but then she pushes him down like once, and he gives up on trying to stop her at all, and then they imply he somehow imbued some ki power into the blade she took from him? Anyway, moving right along. U1 Murmur turns out to have been calling to U3 Yuno all along, and the reason she's doing so is because she wants U3 Yuno to take U1 Yuno's memories because she doesn't want to cast them away. Those are pretty deeply unpleasant memories, but U3 Yuno just takes them anyway because whatever. And for some reason, this leads to them somehow being able to break a barrier between universes, and Yuno gets to finally see Yuki again. It's a somewhat happy ending, but I didn't really have any investment in their happiness, and it just felt really weirdly like an ass pull for how they even did it anyway, so... Mirai Nikki is an exceptionally terrible show. It does so many things wrong that it's hard to even applaud it for what it does well. Like, sure, it has some pretty great animation quality, especially for 2011, but I've seen better stories on Wattpad. Sure, it had great music, but I could just listen to the soundtrack by itself if I wanted that, couldn't I? Sure, it has a great opening, but why watch the anime for that when I can watch an upload of that alone on YouTube? None of its appeals are important enough to draw me in for a full watch, because the bad simply outweighs any potential goods. And most of the potential goods are only good in theory, because they're never delivered upon to their full potential. I wanted to like this show. Believe me, I wanted to like it when I watched it for the first time and I had no prior expectations of it. I wanted to maybe somehow end up liking it when rewatching it, thinking maybe all those years ago, I just got mad about it unnecessarily, and it really wasn't that bad. But it really was that bad. It's always been that bad, and it still is. I know some people like this series, and trust me, far be it from me to try and rain on your parade for that. Clearly, you have the ability to get some enjoyment out of something that I struggle to see any appeal in, but that doesn't make you bad or stupid. Frankly, you just have a little more joy in your heart for something than I do, which isn't something to feel stupid about. But for me, I came into Mirai Nikki hoping for a gripping story, hoping to have a great experience, and the worst part is that I didn't lose hope within the first episode, or even the first few episodes of the show. It was a slow creep, starting relatively decently, and realizing as it kept going that it just kept getting more intolerable by the second. And by the time you're in that deep, it's a sunk cost, right? You have to keep going, because you came this far. The shows that disappoint me the most aren't the outright terrible ones, with no redeeming qualities whatsoever. Those don't give you really any expectations about what they'll be like. You're not holding out for a masterpiece there. No, the most deeply disappointing shows are the ones with potential that end up squandering that potential, because then it's no longer a question of how can something so bad exist. It becomes a question of why did something that had the chance to be so good turn out like this? And it's really a shame. I think Mirai Nikki has some strengths in its premise and concepts, and as few and far between as they were, some actually pretty well-handled moments. It makes me wonder what it could have been if better choices were made in the way that it was written. But sadly, I suppose we'll never know for sure. All we can say is that if Sakai Esuno had a future diary, he might have made a better fucking manga!